Hypercalcemia is a condition where there are elevated levels of calcium in the blood. The normal range for calcium is 2.1 to 2.6 millimoles per liter, or 8.5 to 10.3 milligrams per deciliter. The largest store of calcium in the body is in the bones, which holds approximately 99% of the calcium. The remaining calcium is mostly in the plasma, where some is bound to albumin and other carriers and is considered inactive, while around 45% is free and active. Calcium is mostly absorbed in the small intestine, but only around 20% of the total intake gets absorbed. Several hormones are involved in adjusting calcium levels. These include activated vitamin D, known as calcitriol, which aims to increase calcium levels, parathyroid hormone, which also increases calcium levels, and calcitonin, which reduces calcium levels in the blood. As we said, activated vitamin D causes calcium levels to rise in the blood. 7-dehydrocalciferol is produced in the skin when exposed to UV light, as well as intake from the diet. This is then transported to the liver and converted into 25-hydroxyvitamin D. This is then delivered to the kidneys and is acted on by the 1-alpha-hydroxylase enzyme found in the proximal convoluted tubules, forming activated vitamin D, known as 1,25-dihydroxyvitamin D, or calcitriol. This causes increased absorption of calcium in the GI tract, increases reabsorption of calcium in the proximal tubules of the kidney, and increases calcium release from bone. Parathyroid hormone comes from the parathyroid glands found on the back of the thyroid and is secreted when the level of calcium in the blood drops, typically under 10 mg per deciliter. It aims to increase the calcium concentration in the blood. It does this by activating 1-alpha-hydroxylase, leading to more production of activated vitamin D. Parathyroid hormone will also increase calcium reabsorption at the level of the distal convoluted tubule of the kidney and increases mobilization of calcium from bone. Calcitonin is a hormone released by the thyroid C cells and acts to decrease calcium levels in the blood. It does so by limiting calcium release from the bones and decreasing calcium reabsorption in the kidney. The two main causes for hypercalcemia are hyperparathyroidism and cancer, making up 90% of cases between them. Primary hyperparathyroidism most commonly comes from a solitary adenoma, a benign tumour that produces parathyroid hormone, but you can also have primary hyperplasia, parathyroid carcinoma, MEN1 or MEN2A, or familial isolated hyperparathyroidism. Secondary hyperparathyroidism may come from lithium use or familial hypocalciuric hypercalcemia, where not enough calcium is excreted in the urine and so it builds up within the body. Neoplasms were the other big cause. Hypercalcemia secondary to neoplasm can be divided into four main groups. The first is parathyroid hormone related peptide release, and this accounts for 80% of cases. It is a peptide that has very similar effects to parathyroid hormone. Squamous cell cancers, renal and bladder cancer, breast cancer, and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma are the main malignancies associated with causing hypercalcemia via parathyroid hormone-related peptide. Hypercalcemia related to osteolytic metastases is another mechanism, mostly from breast cancer and multiple myeloma. For multiple myeloma, this is mostly due to release of RANK ligand, IL-3 and IL-6 locally. Then we have 1,25 vitamin D mediated hypercalcemia, where we have ectopic activity of the 1-alpha hydroxylase enzyme, leading to 1,25 dihydroxyvitamin D, or calcitriol, which occurs most commonly in lymphomas and ovarian germ cell tumours. Parathyroid hormone related hypercalcemia can be caused when we have ectopic production of parathyroid hormone. This is most commonly seen in small cell lung cancer and adenocarcinoma. Other causes of hypercalcemia include hypervitaminosis D, elevated 1,25-hydroxyvitamin D, as can happen particularly in granulomatous diseases like sarcoidosis, TB, and Crohn's disease. You may also get rebound hypercalcemia following rhabdomyolysis, and conditions with a high bone turnover can also cause it, seen in hyperthyroidism, multiple myeloma, Paget's disease, and prolonged immobilization. You may also see it in kidney failure and acromegaly. Medications that can cause hypercalcemia include thiazide diuretics, lithium use, and excessive intake of vitamin D or A. Signs and symptoms of hypercalcemia can be remembered with a mnemonic. Stones indicating kidney or renal stones, but you should also remember other renal symptoms here, such as renal tubular acidosis, renal failure, and nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. Bones for bone pain, Moans for abdominal pain, and non-specific symptoms like fatigue and nausea. Thrones for constipation and frequent urination, muscle tone for muscle weakness and hyporeflexia, and psychiatric overtones for depression, anxiety, and cognitive dysfunction. This is why calcium should be included in a confusion screen. Diagnosis is based primarily on the lab values of calcium, followed by investigations into the cause of the hypercalcemia, which would mostly involve investigating for malignancy or hyperparathyroidism, the latter involving further lab values like alkaline phosphatase and phosphate, as well as immunoassays and potentially x-rays, which can show the salt and pepper sign. This is seen on an x-ray of the skull due to very small lucencies caused by resorption of trabecular bone. Hypercalcemia can induce arrhythmias or even cardiac arrest. Therefore, an ECG may also be useful. Typical findings include a shortened QT interval, while severe hypercalcemia can produce ECG changes that are similar to ST elevation myocardial infarction. A wave known as the Osborne wave may also be seen, which is typically associated with hypothermia. The aim of treatment is first to decrease the calcium level and subsequently to treat the underlying cause. Generally, active treatment is indicated in calcium levels greater than 12 mg per deciliter, 3 millimoles per liter, or particularly if the change is acute. Fluids are first line because patients are likely to be dehydrated due to vomiting or dysfunction of the kidneys, leading to an inability to concentrate urine. This will also help to reduce the concentration of calcium. A loop diuretic is often used following rehydration, mainly to allow large volumes of fluids to be given while minimizing the risk of overload and pulmonary edema. Loop diuretics also tend to reduce calcium reabsorption, aiding in reducing calcium levels. Surgical intervention is also an option, especially for primary hyperparathyroidism. Bisphosphonates can be given, which are pyrophosphate analogues with a high affinity for bone, which get taken up by osteoclasts and reduce their activity, which is normally to break down bone and release calcium. These are particularly important in hypercalcemia associated to malignancy. Similarly, denosumab is an option as it is a RANK ligand inhibitor, which itself is an activator of osteoclasts. Calcitonin can also be given, which is a hormone that counteracts parathyroid hormone, and steroids may be used in special circumstances because they increase urinary calcium excretion and decrease intestinal calcium absorption. However, they are not useful in primary hyperparathyroidism, but are useful when the cause is due to osteolytic malignancies. Dialysis may also be used in patients with kidney failure.